5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better... Sir? Gia!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Hope your weekend's going great. Happy Father's Day to all the dads out there listening. You know, I love doing shows where we include reported Sasquatch sounds throughout the show and we talk about them. Shows like this are very, very fascinating to listen to. And I'll be putting up on the website some of the sounds you hear tonight on the show. If you go to SasquatchChronicles.com, there's a blog on there. I'll probably post most of the sounds to that blog, but the website has additional shows that you can listen to throughout the week. So if you get a chance, check out SasquatchChronicles.com. My guest tonight is Randy Savig, and he is a researcher from the MABRC, which is short for Mid-America Bigfoot Research Center. Well, Randy, I want to welcome you to the show. I appreciate you coming on tonight, and I appreciate you sharing some of the different audio that you have and talking about encounters that you've had. So thank you for being here.
Well, thank you for having me.
It's interesting, you got into this topic not really because of an encounter you had, but because of an encounter your brother had. Do you want to tell us about that?
Well, again, the main thing that got me into it is growing up, you know, I grew up in northern Minnesota, and I had a brother have a sighting up there. And again, ever since he had a sighting, I was fascinated with the subject of Bigfoot. And over the course of several years, of course, with work and family obligations, raising a family and all that, you know, it kind of went to the back burner. Back in 1999, I was unable to work anymore and basically took my research to the internet. And again, did all the reading I could about Bigfoot, the behaviors, whatever. And then in 2012, I joined the group Mid-America Bigfoot Research Center. And in 2012, they, you know, supported me enough to where I felt comfortable going out in the woods and collecting audio and doing boots in the ground type situation in there. And that's kind of what got me going. And again, it seems like this is a very addictive thing because the more you get, the more you want to go out. And I mean, it almost a vicious cycle at this point.
I can completely agree with that. What did your brother see?
Well, we were out deer hunting one time in a normal area that we deer hunted at, and he was about 200 yards away. He saw what he thought at first was a person walking. But again, you know, being rifle season in northern Minnesota, they didn't have orange on. In fact, they were all black colored. And when he zoomed in on it with his scope, he found out it was a whole lot bigger than what he thought it was. You know, it startled him pretty good. In fact, there was one other of my uncles that saw it too, but he refused to acknowledge you know, he was looking at it too, and he said, yeah, I saw something, but I don't know what it was, and I don't ever want to see it again. And, you know, just a curiosity because of that, you know, what is out here? What, you know, is wandering around that we don't know about? And
later in life, you're in a position where you could be an armchair researcher and then eventually get back out into the field. And you said that started in 1998. Has your opinion of what Sasquatch is, has that changed at all?
You know, yes and no. I mean, it's very elusive. I knew that from up then, you know, but I was assuming more or less that it was some type of dumb animal, if you will. And I've come to realize that, you know, its elusiveness and with it being able to stay hid like it is and adapt to people being around it, it's not a dumb animal. I mean, the intelligence that this thing appears to have is mind-boggling to me. I mean, they seem to adapt at what we do when we're out in our research areas, to where they can work around us or stay, you know, get out from underneath of us. You know, to this point in time, I don't want to say it's an ape, but I definitely ain't going to call it a human. You know, again, I'm not exactly sure what it is, but it is definitely something very intelligent.
Yeah, I would tend to agree with you on that. You know, very intelligent, but cunning like a wild animal.
Oh, yes, yes.
Now, you actually had a few sightings. Do you want to tell us what you were doing prior to, I think you had, there was one on a ridge, but do you want to tell us what you're doing prior to that encounter and then kind of walk us into the encounter and tell us what you saw?
Well, we had gotten a group of folks together to do some research in a certain area. There was a river channel that goes through, and there were some bluffs on both sides. And this area had, well, there's campgrounds not too far from it. And there were a lot of complaints in campgrounds of coolers getting stolen and coolers gone through, meat and stuff like that taken, and, you know, never the deer taken out of the coolers. So, you know, people were perplexed if it was some teenage kids wanting to get to have a party or something, they'd definitely go after the deer. And we set up that day, and we went out in groups of three. But we separated ourselves by about 150 yards. We'd send one group out, and when they got out of a certain area, then we'd have the second group go in quiet. First group was loud, second group was quiet, third group was loud, fourth group was quiet. Trying to see if there was something in there that the loud group could get the attention of and put them kind of in a vulnerable spot, if you will, where they're watching the first group and not hearing or noticing the second group coming up. And we happened to get lucky that day because, you know, we've tried that tactic before without much luck. But on that day, I was in one of the quiet groups, and I came up, and all of a sudden, well, one guy had to stop and hang back a little bit, his shoe untied or whatever, I don't recall. But I went about 60 feet, 70 feet in front of him, and I just happened to catch out of the corner of my eye some movement up on that one bluff. And I suppose I was probably, well, I'm going to say 300 foot from it at most. But it was on an elevation of about 100, 140 foot above where I was at. And by golly, all of a sudden I'm seeing that thing, it was almost like it was turning. And again, this was from about the waist up is what I was seeing. And it was a reddish color, kind of like a Irish setter in color, seemed to be fairly long hair, especially in the neck area. Now, I'm not sure if that was actually coming off the head, but the hair on the neck or neck area seemed to flow real well when it was in the process of turning. Unfortunately, I never did get a shot at the face or get a look at the face. And it took a few steps and went back into that bluff. And when it back, when it got in the back of the bluff, it started shaking this doggone, it was in bloom, it was a dogwood tree, so it had the big white flowers on it. Flowers were just flying off the thing. And when it was shaking that tree, I had the other researcher come up, and I said, hey, look it up there. And, you know, he said, well, that tree is really moving and there's no wind. I said, yeah, I just saw a red one walk back and now that tree is shaking. You know, that was a good, in my opinion, a good daytime sighting, because that was at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. The sun was still bright and everything else.
How large would you say the creature was?
Well, again, you know, I can't tell you so much on height, but, you know, I'm 6'5" and I weigh 280, and I'd say it was about as twice as wide as I am across the shoulders.
Yeah, definitely, you know, large.
I was amazed at how huge mass that body was. I mean, it just floored me. I couldn't, you know, if I would have seen that in a different setting and not been looking for it, I could have very easily mistaken it for a big cow up there or something, because, I mean, it was just that massive.
And what part of the country was this in?
This was in central Missouri. I've been doing most of my research. My research area is in southwestern Missouri. You know, with the MABRC, I do go into some of their other areas and help researchers out with audio and that type of thing. You know, again, the one that you put on your radio show here a while ago talking about Bennett Expedition, it was in the Bennett area up there.
Yeah, with that, that was one with the chatter.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And, you know, and that one is interesting to listen to, and I'm sure you have more context on it. A lot of people were wondering, well, was there other people out in that area, and it could have been something they were picking up on? And I've heard that weird chatter before, and so I knew it wasn't people, but could you address that comment? Because sometimes people don't understand how much time and effort actually goes into collecting audio. You know, you might get 8 hours of audio, but then you got to sit and listen to it for 8 hours, and then you probably spend another couple days editing it and kind of cutting it down to the areas that you know, instead of having someone sit there and listen to 8 hours of audio, you cut out the portions that you find intriguing. But could you address that on that specific with the gibber that was recorded on that one?
Well, the whole setup with that is, you know, we had one big parabolic that I've got at camp. But that day we went out on a day scouting trip looking for, you know, evidence, structures, footprints, you know, with tall boy trails, that type of thing. And we walked into one area that was behind a bunch of berries. Berries hadn't been ripe, of course, the flower, they were just starting to flower at that time. And we came upon this area that, you know, we really looked like a tall boy trail. And we followed that for quite a while and found this structure. And when we're out on, you know, walking like that, I usually take a drop box out with me. And with that drop box, I hung in a tree about 25 foot off from this trail next to this structure. And we just left it there. That was 2-3 o'clock in the afternoon. And then we went back to camp. And the next day I go back out and collected that recorder. And again, it was in the audio review where I heard what was going on out there. And, you know, we had suspicion that we were being paralleled that day. There were a few knocks. that type of thing. And that night when we did a night hike in there, we did hear some distant screams that was also put on there. Bipedal walking that was recorded from the big parabolic at the camp. In fact, my parabolic is 36 inches. And again, with the microphone replacement, I mean, I can hear, 300-400 yards pretty easy with that thing. And then again, after you get that stuff, it's just a guess. It's your best guess. Use your intuition when you're out there as a researcher. And that's why I put the Dropbox there. And again, I've done that probably 50 times before and listened to nothing but crickets and frogs all night long and didn't have anything happen. So this was one of those times where it paid off. And that entire weekend, I had over 40 hours worth of audio that I had recorded. And again, like you say, you go through it minute by minute. And, with the area that it was at, there are no human trails. So the likelihood of a human is slim to none. I wasn't sitting with the recorder all night, so I can't say 150% that it wasn't. But it was far enough away from everything where I don't think it was anything to do with people in the area. What I find the biggest thrill in this audio is setting it up to where you're getting their natural interactions rather than, provoked by someone being at camp, call blasting, knocking, stuff like that. I mean, the screams and stuff, yeah, they still put the hair in the back of my neck up. But to me, Christmas hits when I do an audio review and I get something that's just really unusual.
Editing audio isn't as sexy as people think. Like you said, you might have a 40-hour audio recording that you have to go through and it'll take you 2-3 weeks to actually go through the thing. And you have to listen minute by minute. The gibber that you captured there, and I hope for the listeners out there, I hope they can hear it. I know there was some rain. I've played this piece of audio before, but I really hope that maybe throw on some headphones. You can hear that weird gibber in the background. The moment I heard it, because I've heard that before when I was out in the forest with Mo and Tim and Bob Garrett and all those guys down in Texas, you hear this weird gibber that's kind of creepy to listen to off in the distance. And that's exactly what it sounded like. I wanted to play this grunt comparison that you have. When was this audio taken?
Okay, well, those two pieces of audio, that the comparison that I sent you, the first part of it was in July, if I'm remembering the month right, of 2014. I don't have my notes in front of me, but that was the first time we got grunt. And again, it was a massive grunting incident. In my YouTube channel, if you would go down, that entire 20 minutes where these grunts were happening is in there. Now, they weren't 20 minutes solid. You could hear from the first time the grunting came with the knocks and all that until they quit. We were on a day hike that day and went into an area. And even though we didn't feel like we were pushed and out of place or anything like that, we didn't feel like we were in danger whatsoever, that grunting was recorded. Now, how that was recorded is I set up a recorder on my truck because I've been working with this same troop now for just about 4 years. And I was noticing some things being moved around in the back of my truck, and not thinking that it could be people just with the area I was in, I was really intrigued at what might have been messing with the stuff. So I started leaving a recorder with the truck and just walking away from it. I just placed it on the windshield wipers, what I do. And that one was recorded. And then the second one that's on there, the same clip, that was just the following spring in the same area, using the same technique. I mean, we just come into an area when we go on a day exploratory hike, we always leave a recorder on the truck. And that's how those grunting incidents were got.
Mm-hmm.
And were you able to rule out any other known animal?
You know, after getting that recording, I spent about 9 months. In fact, that was in 13 that I got it. I put it together a presentation at the Oklahoma Bigfoot Symposium in last year, in 2014, with that grunting incident. It took me about 9 months to go through every known animal I could find, and not only just by listening to it by ear, but also listening to it and looking at it on the spectrograph. You know, that's a signature, for those that don't know. It's a signature of each sound that's out there. You know, and your coyotes, your wolves, your hogs, your bears, they all have a signature that goes along with them. Frequencies as far as the tones they use, but also, you know, there's a profile signature that goes with that. I was going through every oddball critter I could think of that is, you know, native to this area. And then one day, just out of pure frustration, I started looking at, well, it's an internet soundboard is what it was, and they had some grunting on there that matched very closely. Now, again, it's not exact, but very close. And what that was a mountain gorilla.
Really? That's interesting.
You know, and again, you can find that, you know, the grunting that you hear with that, when you listen to the recordings of a mountain gorilla, it's not that far off. Currently, I do have that audio with a primatologist down in Little Rock, Arkansas. And I'm hoping in the next couple of weeks to hear more of whether they think that that is a primate or whether they're discounting it. But you know, there's some folks that have bears up in Minnesota that I know. When I sent the audio clip up there, it's just bears grunting. You know, I've sent it to other places, you know, and gotten no's on every place that I've gone. You know, and the thing that's with that is you can also hear the knocks with it. Some people try to say that the bear is popping its jaw, you know, and I have looked at those audio too, and the match is not there.
This next one is the Missouri Screams.
This is the same as the Oklahoma Springs.
can you tell us what was going on when you recorded that? Can you kind of give us a background on that what we're listening to here?
Okay, the first time I recorded that Manure scream, again, was back in 2013. And again, it was in the wintertime, you know, I'm going to say November-ish. And when I go out into my main research area, I always have a camp recorder. But I usually, if there was a structure or a trail area that I thought they went to on a regular basis, I would set up a parabolic. And that night, that's what I did. I had a parabolic set up, and it was pointed to the west of where I was located at. You know, I was at camp probably half, three-quarters of a mile from there. I never did hear these that night at camp, but with the parabolics, it did pick them up. And, you know, it was, again, just one of those oddball things that I had never recorded before. And since, I also caught it this last winter, fall type situation. Again, there is two Missouri screams on there, and the second one was the duplicate, if you will. You know, one thing as a researcher that I try to do is, you know, science wants us to be repeatable. And, you know, when I can catch the same sound twice, I put them up next to it. And that's what that clip was. That clip is very, very similar to the ones that were caught out on the West Coast in the early 70s. Again, that's one I've also used at my presentations. But I don't know what the thing really means. I mean, I have my speculations on it, but again, it seems to be set up strictly as a long-distance vocalization.
Yeah, you're right. It does have that sound like that was recorded in Washington. I don't have the Puyallup screamer on here, but I do have the Snohomish screamer that was recorded in 1978. Let's take a listen. That is interesting. When you listen to the two sounds, you can definitely hear there's a comparison there.
I set up my YouTube channel for the specific reason of sharing with other researchers. You know, I don't know if you've ever noticed on my YouTube channel, it doesn't come up if you push Bigfoot into it, because again, there's so much of that out there. These were set up as a way of sharing with other researchers what I'm catching here so they can compare it to with what they're catching in Texas and Michigan and wherever else it might be. You know, that's a lot of why I do what I do. And when I start getting repeatabilities, it's just so interesting to have other people come on and say, well, yeah, you know, I've caught that down in Texas. I caught that in, you know, Washington State. There's one that's been caught very similar to that over in Ohio. So again, we have a critter out there making those vocalizations. And again, it doesn't match anything on the known record. You know, like you say, there's a lot of work to audio. When you catch something odd like that, you know, personally, I've never really heard anything like that. Then, you know, once you eliminate the known animals, then I go on to the different Bigfoot sites where they have audio recording, and I listen to them time and time again until I find one that matches, or hey, this is something completely different. And when you get a match on it, again, for me, it puts them a lot more weight on the target critter that we're going after.
You know, I had an interesting phone call with the police officer last week. I talked about it on the show on Wednesday. Have you ever been out to a property where it seems like they're on the property, there's constant behavior going on? Have you ever investigated anything like that?
I've done some of that, but, you know, in fact, I did an investigation not 12, 14 miles from where I have my research area. This family has been living in the same location for about 15 years now, and they've always had stuff move around their property at times. In fact, for 2 or 3 years, they were calling the sheriff's department on a very regular basis, thinking they had prowlers in their yard. and they weren't making the connection of what they were, but they did have some also sightings out there. And then the reason why they got a hold of me through another person is that their 11-year-old grandson had a sighting close, and it was about a quarter mile from their place, and it scared this boy so bad he couldn't move. His brother and one cousin had to literally pull him back home again. He had looked down a holler, and there was this huge brown, hairy thing that had was apparently coming up the holler, but had turned and was going back down. And this 11-year-old boy was so scared, he was petrified. And after that, he wouldn't go, you know, he wouldn't go 100 foot between two houses on that property at the sunset without somebody being with him. I mean, he would literally not go any at night by himself. And the family contacted me and went out, and we did an interview with them, of course. Found out that, you know, they've been having some things happen for quite a while, and, you know, they suspected Bigfoot. But, you know, after the television show Finding Bigfoot came on, you know, it started making more sense to them, because they were hearing other town hall meeting people talking about this, that, the other thing. And they did have, I'm going to say, if I'm remembering right, about 5 different sightings between the adults and then this one with the kid. The adults were pretty firm at what they were seeing. They were standing on 2 feet, large, hairy, you know, stomping around, you know, making some noise. There were dents on one trailer house there that, you know, really looked like handprints from something slapping the side of the house. I got pretty good sized hands, and they were about double my size. Working with this family, you know, the prowler calls that they kept talking about, you know, they couldn't believe Bigfoot was around because of all these prowlers. And I looked at the one boy and I said, hey, tell me about these prowlers. And, well, there's one about this big, one about this big. You know, and he's using his hand as showing me the height. And I said, well, do they ever come in? Do they ever take anything? Well, occasionally there's some stuff missing. I said, like what? Well, let me think for a minute. And I said, well, let me change it. Is there something of value missing? Well, no, not really. I said, now, you know that us country folk down here in Missouri don't really have a problem having guns and taking care of our own stuff, let alone calling the cops and having one of them come up and not have a problem, you know, putting a bullet in your butt. I said, would you go on somebody's property just to mess around for a couple of years, playing around? And the kid just turned white as a ghost. He says, you know, I've sat in the back of that old van several nights, and he said, I've seen him twice as they're coming through. And he says, I always thought they were people. And I said, you know, I don't think they are. I set up and did a 3-night audio session over there. And, I mean, some of what we classify as a classic thoughts of Bigfoot, the knocks, the howls, the whoops, they were definitely all there. So
that's pretty funny that there's no way Bigfoot could be around with all these prowlers around.
Yeah, you know, again, they just weren't getting the doggone connection one way or the other. And one of the benefits of doing this investigation is that last year that 11-year-old boy went out deer hunting with his brother for his first time. And they went out at dark and didn't come in till dark, and he didn't have any problems. You know, sometimes when we're doing this research and investigation stuff, we really have to add the human factor into it. I mean, is there the indisputable evidence out there that I could collect? Well, maybe, but just knowing that I helped the family out, especially that young man, I mean, sometimes that's more important than the evidence.
And I couldn't agree with you more. I mean, sometimes it helps people. You know, like I had a lady on last week, Carol, who had stuff going on for 20 years and really just thought it was weird occurrences that were happening and wasn't really putting two and two together. And I could see that, you know, if you don't believe that this creature exists and if it's not in your daily life, you have weird things going on around your property. You know, you're not going to really pinpoint to, you're not going to come out and say, well, I think it's Bigfoot. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people think Bigfoot only lives in like Washington State, or it only lives in on Bluff Creek. And they're in every state. I mean, they're just, especially down there in Missouri. Have you had any reports about dogmen, or what people are reporting sounds more like a dogman type creature instead of a Bigfoot?
Well, I have worked with, you know, some independent researchers from, you know, again, more in the central part of the state, that those two did have what they said was a dogman experience. And, you know, I've worked with them, and I'd have them in the woods covering my back any time of the day or night. And I believe what they know what they saw, but again, it's still one of those situations that I just have a hard time wrapping my head around it. You know, for part of me saying that, you know, yeah, you know, there's Bigfoot out in these woods. I mean, if there is a dog man and it's not some type of mutated or malformed Bigfoot, then again, that's going to be more of a rare creature than what Bigfoot is. And, you know, I've looked into some of them and heard some of them, and, I don't want to ever run into one if they're out there.
Yeah, no, I heard they have a little bit of a worse attitude and demeanor. I haven't heard one person say anything good about it, you know, coming across and encountering them. I've talked to so many credible witnesses that it's kind of hard to look the other way when they're talking about, when they start describing what they saw. And, you know, I've long, long time Bigfoot researchers that have run into them, you know, they'll be first to tell me, hey, I don't think this is a primate. I don't know what this is I ran into. But it sounds like a freak show. The researchers you go out with, they actually had an encounter with the dogman, or what they thought?
Yeah, they did. They were out in their primary research area, and, you know, they said that all of a sudden they started feeling, you know, like they were being followed, and not in a positive way. It felt like they were prey, for lack of a better way of putting it. And they went to bright lights, and they ended up seeing this thing, and they shot at it, and again, they say they hit it and hit the ground and then took off and ran down the holler and disappeared. The next day they went out, and they could find where it had shuffled around and this and that, and followed it as far as they could, and then it, you know, went into an area they couldn't continue to follow it. And I know it really shook those guys up. And again, it's one of those things that there's been other sightings of them. I mean, but one thing that's down here in the Arkansas area that gets reported from time to time is hyenas.
Because of the sound, or people are actually seeing hyenas?
They're actually seeing them.
That's,
you know,
strange.
So again, yes, I'm out here as a Bigfoot researcher, but, you know, there could be a lot of other things that go thump in the night out there, you know, and again, that's part of this mystery. I mean, we're just, because we focus on one and people are, you know, hey, this guy, you know, will listen to these stories, even though everybody else thinks I'm nuts. Well, then again, all of a sudden you get these other oddball things coming in. The hyena, you know, the Ozark howler is one that was suspected that it was probably some sort of hyena. Over in just on the other side of the Branson area, there's been some reports over there of possibility of a hyena type situation, and I've seen a couple of pictures that have been taken, and then, you know, it's a four-legged critter, but exactly what it is, I have no clue.
That's crazy. I've never heard that before from that area. Yeah, right. I mean, there's so many weird things out there. You know, when people start telling you, you know, they ran into this or they ran into that, sometimes it's hard to get a clear picture. I wanted to ask you about the mimicking. Your audio file, mimicking, does it happen? Let me play it real quick.
Every time I've been on beep, that was the first time I encountered it, and really do it.
can you walk us through that audio? Tell us what's going on there.
Well, you bet. You know, when I first took this back into the woods, you know, back when I first started with the MABRC, I was out in an area, and it was real early one morning, I'm going to say 5:30 in the morning, and I hear what sounds like a backup alarm. Now, what I mean by a backup alarm is I worked in factories for many years, and every forklift has got one on it. Your dump trucks and some of your larger trucks have got it on, where that's that beep, beep, beep that you hear when they're backing up. I caught some audio that sounded like that, and it sounded off. Let's just put it that way. It's so much deeper tone than I've ever heard of a backup alarm. And that particular night that we caught that, again, my partner and I were out in the doggone woods, and I was telling Bernie of this experience that I had had with audio and what I had heard. And during that explaining it to him, there was three or four times where I went beep, 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 you know, trying to get the lower tone down like what I had heard on that morning's recording. And we didn't hear it at camp, but I was using a H2 recorder that I set on top of the truck, and it was picking up somewhere out in the woods something, again, answering. Every time I'd quit talking, it would go beep, beep, beep. And, you know, the first time I heard that, I thought, now, wait a minute, this is an echo. Went down, and again, I was probably talking about it for 15 minutes, and each time through there, that beep, beep, beep that I'd do was repeated. And it always waited until I had quit talking. The last part of that beep, beep that you're hearing, you'll hear me talk for quite a bit afterwards, and then there was again, beep, beep, beep. For me, hearing that once was okay, maybe I'm misinterpreting some other sound. But when it happens four times in one night, and then again, in a matter of about a 15-minute time frame, that's beyond coincidence. And I do know that this area that I was in, there's no way there would have been other people there without us knowing about it. So something out there was mimicking that beep, beep, beep that I was doing. Now, it just does so happen that about a mile from that location is one of these medical transport companies have a driver out there. And each evening they back in their truck that they use for hauling medical patients. And I have no doubt that it's got a backup alarm on it. But, you know, when it's that far away, happening that many times, there's no way they were, you know, backing it back and forth in the driveway and that type of thing. And then the second part of that clip, that area is one of my main listening posts for the simple fact of the activity we've had there. And that other stuff, you know, was it mimicking? I mean, we were out there the night, but we had left recorders when we went in about midnight, and that was recorded after that. You know, I don't know. I highly suspect that they are very good at mimicking. I mean, I've never seen one mimic, so I can't say I know they are, but I highly suspect it. But I'm wondering at times if maybe this mumbling we hear, this chatter that we're hearing, you know, I'm still at a spot where I got a coin toss. I mean, is that mimicking what they're hearing from people, or is that their own? And, you know, about half the time I'll stand and say that's their own. About half the time I question and say, well, is it a mimic? But again, very interesting audio when you start catching stuff like that.
Yeah, it is. It is very interesting. You know, I think that my personal opinion on it, you know, my 2 cents on it, which is actually worth about $3.26, but my 2 cents on it is, you know, when you hear the real fast chatter, and I know you've heard it before being an audio guy, kind of like Ron Moorhead, I think it's his first CD, where he has that real quick, it sounds like monkey chatter going back and forth. Ha 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 ha! And I know most people have heard that before. That's actually Ron Moorhead's chatter he captured back in the 70s. And I would think that that would be more of their language. Every animal has a language. For me, I would say that would be more of their language. They do mimic people, though. We hear it all the time. You know, it's interesting. I was talking to a tribal elder in Oklahoma, and, you know, we got to talking about the chatter and the mimicking and the different things that these creatures do. And one of the things that he said that I thought was fascinating was he said, you know, a lot of people, he laughs when he hears Bigfoot researchers say that these things speak some sort of native language, like the Choctaws or like the Apaches, or he goes, they don't speak Native American. He goes, they mimic us the same way they mimic anyone else, the same way they mimic English or Spanish. He goes, they do have the ability to mimic. But if I were to hear their language, if someone were to come to me and say, this is their language, that recording that Ron Moorhead has would make the most sense to me.
And I do believe that, you know, I mean, with our language, we get used to cadence kind of type situation where, you know, words flow in a certain way. And, you know, certain words can, you know, we can hear that cadence and not hear the words, and we can put an English phrase into it. You know, that doesn't mean that what we heard was English, and it doesn't mean that that's what was said. But, you know, back to this whole mimic part. You know, one night we were at camp and I had a recorder 3/4 of a mile away, and I've got a very distinct laugh, and I'm sitting listening to myself laugh 3/4 of a mile from where I'm at, and there's no way the sound could have traveled that far. Again, my buddy was out there one night. Well, it's while we take our grandkids out, because again, they just have a hoot going out, you know, and it doesn't matter if it's a screech owl that sounds off, you know, it freaks them out. You know, they just have all sorts of fun. And Bernie, getting tired of listening to three girls chatter, he decided to walk around his backside of his truck and kind of clear his head a bit. And he was back there, and all of a sudden he says, "Who called my name?" Nobody at camp had said his name. But as he was standing closer to the woods, further away from camp, he heard his name, Bernie, as clear as a bell.
That's, you know, disturbing.
Yeah, unfortunately, the parabolic was in the wrong direction. I could not catch it on audio. But yeah, it was an experience that was definitely eye-opening for him.
And was anyone calling his name during that trip?
Well, again, you know, all night long, I mean, you know, Bernie this, and my grandkids call him Bernie. I mean, if they would have said Grandpa, he would have thought it was his own granddaughter that was out with us. But, you know, again, the name Bernie has been settled tons of times out there, so it wouldn't be unusual for it to be repeating it.
Yeah, and you hear that a lot with people's encounters, especially if they have them around their property. I can't tell you the countless people I've spoken to who say they thought what was their voice calling for their dogs out in the woods, stuff like that. Or a husband, sounds like a husband's calling for his wife out in the woods, but he's not in the woods. And it's just, you hear that and it's just kind of disturbing. And I don't know why it's so disturbing, but it's just disturbing to me.
Well, I also think that's a lot of the reason why a lot of people want to give them a human type aspect. Because, you know, again, they're thinking that they, you know, do they know what a Bernie is? I doubt it. They hear it, so they repeat it, you know. You know, again, it's one of those things that it's a difficult subject. Again, is it mimicking, or is it language, or is it a combination of both? And that's where I probably stand 90% of the time. So, you know, I have no doubt that they can mimic. I've heard it. I've experienced it. I mean, I was out one day and I was headed in a certain direction, and all of a sudden I heard, "Hey," what did I do? I turned around to see where it came from. And I have a sneaky feeling that might have even been a distraction at that point. Because that's something that, you know, how many times when we walk through the woods, I don't care whether you're hunters or even the people that ride the horses out in the woods and different things. You know, if you want someone's attention, what do you do? Hey.
Right. You felt like it might have been a distraction?
Yes, I did. I did. I mean, I was deliberately going in that direction for a reason, and all of a sudden I could hear this hay, and I turn around. And I think there was something closer than what I was expecting, and when I got too close, the distraction was there for it.
What's your feelings on shooting one and bringing it in?
Well, again, I think that, you know, to have science say, yes, there is one out there, a specimen has got to happen. Whether that's hit by a logging truck, whether that's somebody taking a specimen, personally, I won't pull the trigger unless I feel that there's no choice because of bodily harm to myself. You know, just the logistics involved with it. I mean, if you're back, you know, 3 miles from the nearest trail and in thick woods, and say you were lucky enough to shoot one, how are you going to ever get it out, you know? And then again, there's also, you know, the siege in Hanobi, they talked about one going down and two picking it up and carrying it off. I can pretty well tell you from my experiences, there's very seldom just one around, in my opinion. So, you know, by doing so, are you putting yourself into a lot of danger? You know, I don't know, but that's, again, with my not being able to walk and move around real well, that's not an option I even consider out there, unless, again, it would be, you know, coming after me or mine, and then I will defend myself, but that'd be the only way I'd do it.
I can understand that, you know, not wanting to pull the trigger. I think there's a lot of people that probably wouldn't be very heartbroken if one was shot and brought in.
Well, again, I think, you know, unless science changes its parameters a bit, it will take some of the audio evidence, some of the track casting and handprint castings and the fingerprints and the pictures, and, you know, unless science is willing to use that to say, yeah, something is out there, the only other way is going to be a specimen.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Randy, I know that you're a member of the MABRC. I know you guys have your own podcast. I know you guys do a lot of expeditions. Do you want to do a little promotion of your guys' group?
Yes, we do have a website out there. We also run an annual, or we have for the last 3 years, 4 years. This will be the 13, 14. This will be the fourth year of the Oklahoma Bigfoot Symposium is put on by the MABRC. It's a great group of guys as far as I'm concerned. We do a lot of expeditions. We do have expeditions that we allow independents to come in with us and run the woods with us so we can all learn together and try to figure things out. We have some expeditions that are, again, way back in the boonies that we kind of keep closed. We want more seasoned researchers out there because of the reported activities out there. But, you know, we've got a whole big website, you know, the MABR or MidAmericaBigfoot.com is it. And again, each one of us got what we call a field name or screen name. I don't know which one came first, but, you know, we've got so many Randys out there that we have, you know, if we're out in the woods and there's three Randys and someone says, Randy, look to your left, which Randy is he talking to? So we all go by field names, and, you know, mine is Rebelistic. And I've got a research thread there that goes through all of the research that I do. A lot of my audio was posted there, a lot of observations, and, you know, I try to keep that pretty much up to date with the new stuff that's coming out.
Why not just go by your wrestler name, Randy Savage?
Well, actually, the last name is pronounced Savig, not Savage, but yeah, it's happened 1,000 times, so.
Yeah, no, I hear you. I had to ask a question, you know, if
No, that's fine. Heck, no problem at all.
Well, Randy, thanks for being on the show. I can't thank you enough. Keep me up to date with stuff going on, will you?
Oh, yeah. Well, again, I definitely, you know, again, 4 other researchers and y'all, you know, when I get something that I think is good, I do put it on that YouTube because, again, my clips are more than about, you know, a minute, and that's all that most of these websites can handle. So I opened up to YouTube to be able to get the long clips on there. And, you know, any of your listeners got questions, they can, you know, definitely leave them on the YouTube about a question on those audio that I've got posted. I'll be more than happy to answer any questions.
Hey, thanks so much.
Thank you for having me.
And I want to thank the audience for joining us tonight. Hope you enjoyed the show. If you get a chance, please visit SasquatchChronicles.com for additional shows and check out the daily blog. If you've had an encounter, please email me, Wes@SasquatchChronicles.com. Until next time, everyone, have a great night. Have a great weekend.
Something acquired. The lights on.